Well, you know, I'm starting to worry that I'm going to be replaced in a few years. Giving the keynote is always fun, but clearly he's going to be able to do it better. What I want to do today is talk about how we are on the verge of the golden age of invention, entrepreneurship, and change. Invention, it's wonderful. Change is scary. Probably we will have the biggest problems because the speed of change is going to be too aggressive for many people. Let me tell you about my journey for a minute. Come on, there we go. That's me. I was a ham radio operator. If you were a geek in the 50s, that's what you did, because the computers hadn't been invented yet. And then I worked at I was getting an engineering degree, and I saw a game being played on a big on the screen right there. This is a PDP-1. This was 1966. And at the same time, I was working in an amusement park to put myself through college. Yeah, it had a roller coaster in the whole nine yards. But then I decided I had an arcade and I understood the economics of the coin-operated game business. And I knew that if I had that screen in my arcade, people would put quarters in. But 25 cents into a $1 million computer, and the math didn't work. So I filed it away, and 4 years later, I decided to build Computer Space, which was an attempt to bring that game to the masses in a coin-operated form. This game was okay, but it wasn't huge. It was too complex for most people. All my friends loved it. All my friends were engineers. So I decided something for the masses was necessary. And so I came up with this game, and the video game business took off. Now, think about change. People would ask me, how does the TV station know that I turned the knob? Because they'd never seen anything on their TV screen that wasn't produced at a TV station. That was how much the change happened. But it was for entertainment, so it wasn't scary. Then I did a thing called Chuck E. Cheese, which was a restaurant that used games and a lot of fun for kids. And then I did a automobile navigation system. This was 1979, 1980, we mapped the world, and it's the basis of Google Maps and all that, our database. And then I did a robot. Now, it wasn't as good as this one, and this was my lab. I cleaned it up for this picture, but it was one of those fun things that it ran around and did little tasks, but it was not successful. It was a little too much, too fast, and the technology was not good enough. About this time, I hired a guy named Steve Jobs. And Steve was a very passionate employee, but he didn't get along with others very well. And so I put him on the night shift, and he brought Wozniak in. And so it was like hiring two Steves for the price of one. And those two became later famous and did Breakout for me, which was a very, very successful game. This was done by... He then offered me one-third of Apple Computer for $50,000. And I turned him down. Subsequently, I've regretted that decision. I think that it would have been a smart thing to do, but so be it. We have a big bunch of changes. We can go down one of two roads. We can reject technology or slow it down, because you can't really stop it, or we can embrace it. Creative destruction is real. At the turn of the century, 1821, Ned Ludd started the Luddites. And he was a weaver, and he got thrown out of work by the Jacquard loom, steam-powered weaving machines. And he started the movement to stop technology. By times 1850, there were more soldiers in England fighting the Luddites than he deployed to fight Napoleon. We're going to be facing this, in my belief, because people don't like the idea of losing their jobs. And when the change happens too fast, there's going to be pushback. Ned could have just walked across town and been part of building the British rail system. Different job, better pay, but different skills. This is what we're doing. I want to live here, and here, or here, or here. The future has so much to offer that we have to keep our minds clear that we've got to do things bigger, better, more intelligently. One of those areas is nanotechnology. And I feel as a keynote, I need to just touch on some of the new things. And later speakers will be going deeply into many of these things. But here we go, nanotechnology. We can now create nanotubes that are 1,000 times stronger for the power of, for the amount of weight. What does that mean? That means that we can do micro machines, we can do all kinds of wonderful things on the molecular scale that will change the way we deliver health, the way we deliver drugs, and we'll be able to create the space elevator. The space elevator can get a kilogram into orbit 1,000 times cheaper. Some people think 10,000 cheaper. So all of a sudden, space exploration becomes probable. Quantum computing, DNA computing, doing things using the biome in new and fascinating ways. Today it feels to me like DNA is in fact equivalent to where the transistor was in the 60s. So we've got a lot of technology. Wetware will be wonderful. The Internet of Things, IoT. We will have so many things connected into our lives that the internet and our human beings will become inseparable. There are now 704 companies, and this slide is old. There's probably well over 10,000 Internet of Things companies providing everything from smart toilets. And you say, what's that about? Well, you get up one morning and all of a sudden it tells you that you've got cancer, or it tells you that you're pregnant. If it tells me I'm pregnant, I've got a real problem. But then that's another story. Bitcoin, very important. What are we going to be using as the transaction, as the internet becomes more and more pervasive in all of our lives? Cast AR, the ability to play board games that come alive with your friends. Magic Leap. I don't know why anybody wants a whale in their gymnasium, but it's one of the promises. There's all kinds of fun stuff going on. It's like a dark and stormy night, and the HoloLens and the augmented reality brings everything to life in a new way. Samsung, HTC, have these wonderful systems, Sony, that bring the world and technology together. Of course, we know Pokemon Go. There's a moment factory where they create major installations and parks. Can you imagine walking through this park as in Montreal, in which the whole park comes alive with light and sound and action? The whole world becomes the playground of entertainment. And why is this important? It's because if you look at the way people spend money, particularly millennials, we're moving from a goods economy of things to an experience economy of fantasy, of games, of experiences. And so experiences is a very important part of the things that we need to be creating, fixing, and inventing. These places are fun. George R. R. Martin, who wrote The Game of Thrones, it's a very big TV program. I guess you have it here in Korea too, where everybody gets killed every few episodes. Well, he put together a large warehouse and put artists together. And in Santa Fe, New Mexico now, there is a warehouse in which every 10 square meters, or 3 square meters, there's a room that are all wildly different. This is one, this is another, this is another. There's new kinds of games coming. This is a story type game. Amazon Echo, voice recognition. I live every day with Echo. I wake up in the morning, I say, Echo, or Alexa, that's the key word. What are my schedules for today? What's the weather in Korea? When does my plane leave? And she tells me. And then 2 years ago, or a year ago, I programmed Alexa so that I could say, Alexa, turn on Christmas. And I had some of the smart plugs that would turn on the Christmas tree, turn on the outside lights, and start playing Christmas carols. One command. Now, it took me a half hour to do that, so I'm not sure I actually saved time, but it was very impressive for my friends. Device 6 is an app that blends story with game in a very interesting way. And I believe in augmented and virtual reality, we're going to be seeing this more and more. PlayStation VR, Oculus, Modal VR, this is actually my company. And we're building a system in which we can put 10 people in the same construct, track them over a football field, and set up and tear down in 15 minutes. And we're aiming it towards police training, military training, industrial walkthrough, amusement park creation, and we're basically on the commercial side. And this is our sort of signature game. It's Mythic Combat. I'm standing on top of a high rise. My opponent is standing on the top of another building, and I'm throwing plasma balls at him, and he's throwing lightning bolts at me. It's really fun and one hell of a workout. There's also a unit that we have where you can walk through and you actually In VR, you can edit your environment. We think that VR is going to be important for education, because education, our brains were built in the, 35 million years ago when we were on the savannah, where everything that we did had a geopositioning to it. So we're used to thinking in terms of geospatial items. You will be able to remember what you learn if you walk through it better than if you just read about it, by a lot. So we think this will be changing a lot with education. I'm doing games with Spill Games, the Future Group. This integrates real live motion into some of the game engines, Unreal, Unity, what have you. WT Fast normalizes connection speeds. Let me talk about the self-driving car for a minute. The self-driving car is going to kill, in the United States alone, about 16 million jobs. But it's more important than world peace, because even in war, we don't kill as many people as we do on the roads. So there are all kinds of things. These are the jobs that are going to be eliminated. But what are the jobs that are going to be created? I'll talk about those in a few minutes. Of course, there's robots everywhere. Drops the cost of manufactured goods. Bioimplants, changing medicine. There's automated farms. What's this person doing? This person is a cowboy. It's projected that within 15 years, 80% of the hamburger we consume will be done in vats. These people will be the cowboys of the future, creating beef for consumption. No waste, just nutrients, growing beef protein in vats as a chemical process. Medical diagnosis, retail automation, all these things change the world in a very important way. But education has to change the most, because without good education, we will not be able to accomplish the changes that are necessary, because the skills required for tomorrow's jobs are different than the skills that we have today. We have to be collaborative. Classrooms don't work. If somebody says that they're in the third grade and they got an A, it's a bad school system. Being in a grade means that you are being batch processed. Everybody should be an individual. It should be granular. It's like schools were invented before the internet. You should move at your own pace. In a classroom, there's one person being taught at the right speed. The other half are bored. The other half are lost. We have to change our school systems, and we need to change them soon. Not this way. This is what they envisioned the school system being in the future. I want to point out that we've seen major disruptions in the workflow before. In 1930, being a telephone operator was a significant career path. Today, with the number of telephone calls and texts that are being created, it would require more telephone operators than people existing on the earth. Clearly that wouldn't work. And if they were all telephone operators, there wouldn't be as many telephone calls. So there's going to be an equilibrium somewhere. But think of the massive disruption that happened when just with a simple dial telephone. Understand that we're also translating from atoms to bits. Now, what do I mean by that? You can generally wholesale out of China, buy a pair of jeans for $6 wholesale. But by the time I buy a pair of jeans, I'm probably spending $60. When my wife buys jeans, she generally does $200. So what's the difference? The difference between that $6 and the $200, that's all bits. It's design, it's fabrication, it's creation, it's marketing, it's brand creation. Bits are more and more important. Atoms, less and less important. Again, experiences. These are the fun things. What are the new jobs in the future? We're going to need to garden all our streets. I say, garden your streets? What do you mean? All transportation will be underground. The self-driving car doesn't need to see where it's going. And therefore, it can become small, and it would be very easy to just dig down, maybe a little bit, berm it over. We, because we're used to it, we don't realize how ugly cars are. We don't realize how noisy and how much disruption. Think of going to work walking through a park. When you want to get a car, you just go down a pair of stairways and it'll pick you up. I believe that we will have an ability to garden all our streets, even in the neighborhoods. I know for myself that I would pay just a little extra to not have the noise and clutter of automobiles. Also, stop to think about a taxi system that can insert a container or get rid of a container. If the taxi is turning left and the tag on the container says it's going right, it deposits it at a corner and then waits for a car that's going right. It becomes a packet switch network for goods. Those kinds of things change the way the world of economy works. It becomes vanishingly cheap to ship a product because most of the cost is in the last mile. This is the world I want to live in. I don't want to see cars. But more than that, the self-driving car will be able to travel safely at 200 kilometers, 300 kilometers an hour. And once it's underground, the speed doesn't cause noise. But more than that, nose to tail, all traffic jams go away. The self-driving car increases the capacity of every lane of traffic by 10. So think if you have a five-lane freeway, it's all of a sudden turned into a 50-lane freeway. Because you can go nose to tail at speed, and it drops the energy cost because each car is drafting the car behind it. To garden our streets, probably 7-9 million new jobs for 20 years, maybe more. That's just in the United States. Of course, we have the Hyperloop technology. It's going to be really important. I personally live in Los Angeles. I want to be able to go to San Francisco for lunch. This will be possible within the next 15 years. In certain places, 10. I think there's a Hyperloop being installed in Dubai as we speak. 10 million new jobs. I think aquaculture is going to be important. and island living. Ever stop to think about how wonderful it would be to have these large islands that you could live on, particularly in retirement? All of a sudden you create a whole bunch of ocean living. It goes a little north when it's winter, when it's summer, travels a little south when it's winter. All of a sudden we have a much bigger world. Most of the ocean is uninhabited. Why be so clustered here in our major cities? Let's get bigger, let's get expansive. Let's build all these new things. At least 6 million new jobs. And we'll be able to fix education. Right now, we should have every student hooked up with a laptop, with a personal tutor that they can access at will over the net. And they should learn projects. Everybody should know how to make a YouTube video, create a website, type at least 50 words a minute. We can fix this and we can make it happen for everybody. And entrepreneurship is actually going to be the key. And Korea has a lot of entrepreneurship going on, but it needs more. And so let's talk about what are the steps. Choose your team with care. When you start a company, the first 10 people that you hire are massively important because they tend to replicate themselves. And if you have a flaw in the seed crystal, it will replicate itself forever. And your company will fail, often just because of one toxic team member. Don't start with engineering. Start with marketing. Write a one-pager that says everything about the product or service that you want to do, and then you go get a customer. Your product doesn't need to exist yet. Desktop publishing invention is all you need to commit, and what it does is it creates a very understandable blueprint for what you want to do. The one-pager is powerful, and when people come to me and want me to invest in their company, I ask them, where's your one-pager? Well, let's talk about the technology. I say, no. Let me figure out how you're going to market it. Because if it's going to cost you too much to market it, then the business will fail. Creativity. How do you get some? Do you take a shower? I actually think that there's a bigger process than that. Listen to yourself and ask yourself, what irritates me? What do I not like? For me, I hate to stand in line. So whenever I find myself standing in a line, I say, that's a business opportunity. How do I get rid of this line? But more than that, I think everybody, particularly if you're young, you should go to weird trade shows. For many years, I went to every trade show. Whenever I'd go to Las Vegas, there were about 7 trade shows going on. I'd go to every one of them. I actually had a couple of business cards printed up that said that I was a member of the press so I could get in for free. But even though they were not in my field, you learn something. And a lot of times you can create businesses by creating links between what is known and best practices in one industry that this industry hasn't figured out. Trade shows are probably the most important thing a young person can do. And I tell people, how many trade shows have you gone in a year? If you're a college graduate and you haven't gone to at least 10 in a year, you're not serious about being an entrepreneur. This is really fun stuff. Crazy things happen at trade shows that only happen there because they're a snapshot of an industry. Efficiency, efficiency, efficiency. You also need a skill. I don't know which skill it is, but you need to be one of them. You either need to have some marketing skills, some technical skills, some financial skills, or management skills. Generally, good entrepreneurs who have a success have been an entrepreneur before. Step a team, find a project, start locally. A lot of people say, I'm going to build a product that everybody would want. It's the wrong thing to do. If you design for everybody, you end up sort of designing for nobody. What you want to do is have a very targeted, small market that you can access easily. That's how you can get started. Remember, Facebook started just by focusing on Harvard, and they got it right. And then they went to Yale. So it started out as a college thing. It turned out to be brilliant. It wasn't the first social media. There was Friendster and I forget the name of the other one. But what it did, he entered the marketplace at the right time, at the right way, by not trying to go too big too fast. But you have to move quickly. You got to move quickly. And don't have the paralysis of... There's this thing called the paralysis of perfection. You can always find problems with your own invention. And if you continue to put off getting into the market, you miss the feedback, the churn, the give and take that is really important. Refine and improve. My dad said, when you make a sale, it's not your mouth that is important, it's your ears. Listen, refine, fix. Plan for your exit. Now, if you want to raise venture capital, the number one thing they're thinking about is how do I get my money out? They think less about the being a successful company than who can I sell this to or can I take it public? That's their exit. And figure out how to get rid of risk, because risk kills creativity. Whenever you can drop the risk profile, you increase the creativity. Weird trade shows, embrace the crazy, mash together two industries, edit, and do it now. I want to live here, I want to live here, I want to make the world a better place, and I want to live there. So I want you all to really hurry up and invent this future, because I want to live there. The empires of the mind, the future, are the empires of the mind. Winston Churchill. The future is ours to create. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bushnell. 네, 여러분, 수고해 주신 Bushnell께 다시 한번 뜨거운 박수 부탁드립니다.